Hi everyone, you're watching the Virtual Amicus and I'm Jay Lodha. So today the session is on equalization levy, its constitutional challenge. And for the first time on the Virtual Amicus, we have a chartered accountant who joins us from Bombay. So this time we'll be having two speakers and dealing with one common issue, one common topic. And just to give you all a brief introduction about the topic, we'll be discussing various salient features of equalization levy and where is it applicable, where is it imposed on, where is it defined? Is it defined in the provisions of the Finance Act or is it defined in the provisions of the Income Tax Act? How is it charged? What is the threshold limit? And just to give you all a brief introduction about our amicus for today's session, today we are joined by an advocate who's practicing before Honorable Bombay High Court. We are joined by Mr. Rajan Mishra. And Mr. Rajan Mishra absolutely needs no introduction. He has extensively experienced and worked in high court proceedings involving divisive litigation strategies and high stakes matters. He's worked on indirect tax matters entailing constitutional law and general principles of law. And he's also authored various opinions on the issues pertaining to constitutional validity of tax legislations, charging provisions, etc. and etc. He studied law from Government Law College, Bombay. So thank you so much, sir, for taking our time. And
thank you, Jay.
My pleasure, sir. And today we are also joined by a very dynamic chartered accountant. Her name is Ms. Urja Sanghvi. And just to give you all a brief introduction about our amicus, the amicus number two for today's section, Ms. Urja Sanghvi is a qualified chartered accountant with 3 years of articleship experience in corporate and international tax. She has rich experience in handling clients in technology sector, education sector, FMCG sector, and not-for-profit space. So thank you so much, ma'am, for taking our time on a busy working day. I know it's a very complex issue, but we couldn't have had or asked for better speakers than Mr. Rajan Mishra and Ms. Urja Sanghvi for today's session. So anything that you wish to say before we start with our session?
Yes, Jay, after choosing the topic yesterday, I realized that I have chosen a topic which is very difficult to articulate. And let's see how it goes. Urja is there, like she has done all the research. So yeah, please go ahead.
Okay, thank you for that introduction, Jay. So, yeah, we'll begin now. So, equalization levy, why has it been introduced? To go back a little bit, we understand that over the past decade, information technology has grown exponentially, not only in India, globally. The number of digital transactions and telecommunication networks have increased so much, giving rise to so many new business models. Along with these new business models come new tax challenges, because there is no lack of characterization, the lack of nexus, evaluation of data. Because of the same, as a result, these new business models caused a lot of tax disputes as to the inadequacy of a physical presence-based nexus in the tax treaties or the possibility of these transactions being taxed as royalty or FTS. As a result, to bring some clarity, the Government of India, via the budget 2016, introduced equalization levy as a part of the Finance Act. Now, what is equalization levy? Equalization levy is a levy on consideration received for specified services provided by a non-resident to a resident in India. These specified services includes online advertisement or provision of any digital advertising space or facilities. However, at that time, the levy did not cover within its ambit all e-commerce operators. As a result, the scope of equalization levy was expanded in Finance Act 2020. And this scope now, which earlier applied only to digital advertising, was expanded by way of a sweeping amendment to cover all e-commerce supply of services, including facilitation by an e-commerce operator. So this scope fairly includes in its all digital transactions and services, so long as it eventually targets any customer or an IP address in India.
So
Now Rajan can go ahead and tell us about the test.
So she has already said this, that the enactment is in place. Originally, it happened to be legislated in 2016. It was amended in 2020. Now, the levy is fine. The charging provision of the enactment also is fine. The moment we started researching about the constitutional validity of this, we realized that the parliament is being very silent on the identity of the tax. The parliament is quiet to answer whether this is a direct tax or an indirect one. A question must cross your head. Why do we need to understand this, ascertain this? If it is an indirect tax, for somebody who's paying the tax, must understand that the incidence of the tax has to be passed on. If it is a direct one, then what you do, you incur that as cost. Apart from that, to understand the legislative competence of the parliament, one must know the source of the legislative power. We all know, studied in the law school, that Article 246 of the Constitution empowers the union legislators, that's the parliament, to legislate upon the subject which is there in the list 1 of the 7th schedule. The most relevant entries in list 1 would be entry 82, entry 92C, and entry 97. Entry 82 is tax on income. Now I'll deal with each one of them independently. If it is in, it has been legislated under entry 82, that means the gamut of the transaction entails an aspect which is generation of income. Why do I say this? There are two aspects in the transaction. Uja said that there is provision of service from a non-resident to a resident. So the provision of service is already there. And there's another aspect that there is generation of income in the hands of the non-resident, because the services would flow from non-resident to resident, and the consideration would flow from the resident to the non-resident. And we'll have to give this presumption, otherwise it would be invalidated on the grounds of double taxation. Because if the aspect is the aspect of provision of service, it is already being taxed under online information and database access retrieval services under section 217 of the IGST. So looking at entry 82 and giving the presumption of constitutionality, this perspective gives you an idea that it is a direct tax. Going forward, looking at entry 92C, entry 92C was brought in to introduce a levy in 1994, that is service tax, which was subsequently removed in 2017 with the amendment in the constitution, that is the 101st constitutional amendment. So the equalization levy cannot be set to be introduced under 92C because it has been removed altogether. Now, coming back to the third one, that is entry 97, which is the residuary entry. The very fact that it is residuary, it does not give you an idea that whether it is a direct tax or indirect tax. So possibly either the equalization levy has been legislated under entry 82 or entry 97. So this was the source of the power we tried to examine. We did not get an answer. Now let us go to the statutory definition. Equalization levy has been defined in the statute at 164D of the Finance Act, and in its expression clarifies that the levy is tax on consideration for services on e-commerce supply or services. You get an idea that this is tax on a transaction, it's a transactional tax. So it has to be an indirect. So with this perspective, it appears to be indirect tax. After the definition, we look at the machinery provision. We had a full-fledged tax enactment, which is mother of all tax enactments, that is the Income Tax Act since 1961. They could have introduced a chapter in the Income Tax Act, but they did not do that. They brought it by way of amendment in the Finance Act. But Urja has another idea why it was not brought in the Income Tax Act.
she says that the Union Parliament wanted to keep the taxpayer deprived of the benefits of Section 90, Subsection 2, which is benefit of double taxation avoidance agreement. So therefore, we can have this assumption that it was kept outside the purview of the Income Tax Act only because to keep the taxpayer deprived of the DTA. There's another, do you want that aspect?
Yeah, so we could.
There's a fourth test that she has devised. Is like, please go ahead.
So the aspect theory test, what I understand is to remove the fallacy of, as a result of expansion of the scope of equalization levy, there was a section introduced in the Income Tax Act, Section 1050, which said that any income arising from any e-commerce supply of services chargeable under the levy, that is equalization levy, would be exempt from tax, from income tax. This goes on to show that both these are mutually exclusive in nature, providing that the transactions on which equalization levy is eligible, income tax would not be levied. Thus, the above amendment appears to be in the nature of avoiding double taxation, which goes on to show that this is a direct tax in nature and not an indirect tax, because a lot of times a transaction which has direct tax can also have an indirect tax applicable to it. But two direct taxes will not be applicable at the same time.
So basically, by ascertaining whether this is direct or an indirect tax, we wanted to see the constitutional pedestal it has been kept. So we did not get an answer. This is just an analysis that we are talking about. But when we see Article 14 and test of intelligible differentia, there I have an absolute answer which I'll give you. But before I come to Article 14, for that to be understood, we need to see Article 245. Article 245 of the Constitution states, what has been legislated by the Union Parliament would not be invalidated only on the ground that it has extraterritorial operations. Very well. Now, this extraterritorial operation must have a direct nexus, the real nexus, and it must have an impact on the territory of the country. Just because a provision in the Constitution says that it would not be invalidated, Parliament cannot go ahead and legislate something which has a remote nexus. It needs to have the direct nexus or the real nexus. On numerous occasions, the Honorable Supreme Court has observed and has tried to interpret the concept of nexus and the territorial nexus. Most recent being in the GVK judgment of 2018. Can I read something from that judgment, Jay?
Yes, please. Please go ahead. Please go ahead, sir. If you could also give the citation, so that says, is possible.
So it says, I'll give you the citation also.
Yeah.
Not now though, because I do not have.
Whenever.
The phrase extraterritorial operation, as it appears in Article 245 of the Constitution, has been interpreted by Justice Venkat Iyer in Bengal Immunity versus State of Bihar, AIR 1995, SC 661, in the following terms. The words extraterritorial operations are used in two different senses as connoting, firstly, law in respect of acts or events which take place inside the state but have an operation outside the state. And secondly, laws with reference to the nationals of the state in respect of their acts outside. The words law with extraterritorial. So we are concerned with the first part of what Justice Venkat Iyer said. Now, for the Union Parliament to be led, to have the legislative competence thereof, the charging provision, that is Section 165A, and the situation that is envisaged or the transaction that is proposed to tax must have territorial nexus with the territory of this country. I'll not read because it will become very boring what 165A is. But I'll give you the three situations that has been envisaged. I'll explain one by one. First situation is a simple one. A non-resident providing services to somebody who's resident. There's flow of consideration definitely from the opposite direction, that is from India to a non-resident. The receipt of the consideration is proposed to be taxed. It's a simple transaction. This was the first one. Coming to the second one is, how do I explain this? Urja and me engage in a WhatsApp conversation. We exchange messages on WhatsApp. And she conveys her desire to buy Mercedes. Okay. Now this data, the exchange of message is being taken by WhatsApp, which is Facebook in US. That is being sold to the German company, that is Mercedes, in Europe. So the real transaction here is, the primary transaction that you see here is the sale of data from Facebook to a German company. Both are non-resident. But the nexus there exists with India would be the subject matter of sale, which originates in India. So that's the only nexus that we have. Now remember the first transaction that we spoke about and the second one. Now look at the third one. Jay, you're there on Facebook. Everybody knows for the longest time you are there on Facebook. I see you online. You do not reply to my messages, but you are there on Facebook.
Unfortunately, most of my friends have blocked me on Facebook.
Okay. So you are there on Facebook and there appears an advertisement, there flashes an advertisement on your page. Again, Mercedes, like to be convenient. For this to happen, Mercedes must have paid Facebook some money to target you here in India. So the first transaction, the primary transaction here is Facebook being paid from a non-resident, that is a German company, for the services being given or provided by Facebook in US. And the only nexus that remains with that of India would be you being targeted, you being using IP address in India. That's the only nexus. So clearly and evidently, the transaction in the first category and the transaction in the second and the third category are not equals, but they're treated equally. Article 14 says people should be treated equally. Transaction should be equal. Transaction should be treated equally. Unequal transaction should not be treated equally. Now, since these are different and they are not at the same par, they are not equal, and still being brought to the same levy, treated equally, unequal transactions treated equally would invalidate the guarantee under Article 14. This was unequals being treated equally. I read another proposition by, I read this in commentary on equalization levy by senior advocate Arvind Datar. And he says that equals have been treated unequally. On that count also, it would be violative Article 14. I'll read that part from his commentary. Can I do that?
Please go ahead.
One second. So it reads like this. Two business persons, one operating electronically and one operating physically, are similarly placed persons. Non-resident e-commerce operator will have to bear the levy of 2% if he makes the sale to Indian resident. However, a similarly placed non-resident who makes a sale to a person resident in India by mode of other than online is not liable to levy in India. This is discrimination between two similarly placed persons. So on both the counts, equal treated unequally and unequals treated equally, the equalization levy does not stand the test of intelligible differentia. The classification that has been done is unreasonable. And there it should be violative Article 14 and not constitutionally valid. So yeah. These were the only...
Yes. So thank you so much there, Mr. Shah and Ms. Sanghvi, for clearing most of my doubts. I just have one question, if you have the time and patience to deal and bear with my question. So I don't know, I'm not too sure about it, because but I read somewhere and I remember reading it vividly that there was this OECD G20 tax agreement that countries had entered into. What do you think will be the possible implications of equalization levy? So OECD, if I'm not wrong, is Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development. And it's a group of countries, I think 40 or 50 in number.
It's pursuant to that. It's pursuant to that only such levy is being brought. I'll tell you why.
Okay.
So it adds to the GDP of the country, but then it does not add to the revenue of the central government. So perhaps the reason why countries met, and this is one step. And I must say we are number one globally to have this levy. Some people are saying that it is tax terrorism. Some people are saying it's an international service tax. But then whatever it might be today, the piece of legislation is there with us. If at all it has to be challenged, it has to be challenged on Article 14 count. The first test that we just spoke about, I do not think it would hold much water.
Right there. So before we wrap this up, anything that you wish to say towards the end, any clarification that you think, Parliament should intervene and pass some law that requires some clarification on it, or the Supreme Court should step in and further clarify its position. Anything that,
it was her point. May I please go ahead and say this? So first and the foremost clarification, if at all, has to be there. People must know whether they have to pass the incidence of tax or they should incur that as cost in their books and be happy about it. So that clarification has to be there, because the parliament was very quiet as to whether this is direct tax to be incurred by somebody who's paying it, or indirect tax, the incidence thereof has to be passed to the customer.
Wow. So thank you so much, guys, for this brilliant presentation. They say that nobody understands taxation better than a chartered accountant, and nobody interprets it, the taxation law, better than a lawyer. And we couldn't have asked for better speakers, as I rightly said. And I had predicted in anticipation that it will be a brilliant presentation. So to all the viewers who are watching, in case if you still have any doubts on any of the fundamentals or concepts with respect to this otherwise very technical issue, in the field of taxation, feel free to write to us. We'll be more than happy to forward the same to our amicus. Ziz, we have a plural this time because we have to, for this session. And you can directly write to them as well if you deem it appropriate. So thank you so much, guys. Once again, your presence really means a lot on our channel. As Mr. Mishra pointed out, India might not have been number one, but you guys are definitely number one on our channel, because to take this very challenging issue to deliberate, discuss, and going to such intrinsic details requires a lot of research, a lot of effort that you've managed to do. And we couldn't have asked for a better presentation on this. So thank you so much once again. Any parting words or anything that you wish to say towards the end?
Thank you, Jay. Thank you so much for this.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you so much. Okay, thank you so much, guys. Stay tuned. Next episode is on its way. Stay home, stay indoors. COVID is still around. It's goodbye for now. Thank you, guys.